If I could have your attention really quickly, and then I'll let you get back to visiting. You look great. What a beautiful crowd here this evening. Posted very all up the aisles and different places are these QR codes. If you're my age or older, you don't even know what these are. You're going to need a teenager to help you. But if you'll take your smartphone and you'll take put it on the camera mode and let this pick up and hit the accept, all of the lyrics for our worship will be on your phone. We want you to be able to follow along, and we don't have screens. And so I'll make this announcement a couple times, but they're on the rails going up the stairs on both sides. I'm not sure what's in the middle, but if you need these, go ahead and get your lyrics so you can sing along with us. Thank you. Really quick, again, if you are just getting into the auditorium, these are posted up the aisles on the side. I think Matt Odom's walking around. I've got one as well. Matt's right here. If you will take your iPhone, they told me this will not work on an Android, so I apologize. If you'll look at this with your iPhone and accept it, all the lyrics for our worship music this morning or this evening will be on your phone, and you can sing along. We don't have any screens up, and so we want to make sure you can sing along with us. So go ahead and grab that if you can before we get started. We got about 20 more minutes, so thank you.
Your throne, whisper my own love song. With all my heart, I'll sing. Oh, you, my dad and king. I live for all my days to put a smile on your face. And when we finally meet, it'll be for eternity. And oh, how wide you open up your arms when I need your love. And how far you would come if ever I was lost. You said that all you feel for me is undying love that you showed me through the cross. I worship you, my God.
Forever I will be with you.
I'm sure sorry to sound like a broken record, but a lot of people have come in, and since we told you that, these are hanging up the aisles on the side. People are walking around with them. They are our worship lyrics, and I was told that an Android will read this as long as you have a QR code reader. We're all learning about this stuff tonight, and so if you take your phone out, the lyrics that we have, there's no screen. We want you to be able to sing along with us, and so find one of these up the aisles or somebody walking around. And put those on your phone so we can all sing here in a minute. We got about 10 more minutes. Thank you. That sounds like a perfect time for us to begin our worship. Are you ready to worship tonight?
Yeah.
Well, I like the sound of that. We have a great opportunity. This is one church under one God, under one roof. No matter where you attend on Sunday morning, man, we're all going to spend forever in heaven together. So we might as well start right now. Just worshiping, expressing our love to God. And that's what this first song talks about. It talks about church. It talks about being in the Father's house. Is everybody tuned and ready? Go ahead, Mark. One, two, three. three, here we go. You can stand to your feet if you'd like.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. And my story isn't over, my story's just begun.
Here we go.
Prodigals come home, the helpless find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors swing wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
Miracles take place.
Miracles take place.
Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Sing about heaven, shall we? That gift of Jesus that writes our name in that book of life. It goes like this. You guys ready? 1, 2, 3.
I was once a sinner, but I came, bought it to receive from my Lord. His word, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white robed angels sing the story. The sinner has come home. There's a new name written down in glory.
Yeah.
For the gift of Jesus. I'm going to tell you, you can sit down, you can stand up, you just respond to how you're moved. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood, the flood of His love. Let's sing it together, shall we? 1, 2, 3. Here we go.
I heard an old, old story, how Savior from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save us like me. I heard about His groanings, of His precious blood. promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot bear. When the howling storms of doubt appear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amen. Yeah. Standing on the promises of the Chainbreaker. We're here to hear stories this evening, and we will hear a couple amazing stories, testimonies. We're going to sing a couple songs by a testimony that was partly written. His life spent right here, not only in this town, on this campus, but in this gymnasium. You know him as Zach Williams, and certainly his music and his story and his testimony are well documented, well written, sung all over the place. Ironically enough, as we talked before, this isn't just his story. This kind of follows along to be my story as well. And I found God to be exactly who Zach Williams found him to be and wrote these words. We sing them like this. Here we go. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice and the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life.
All right, sing it.
If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, Chainbreaker. We all search for the light of day and the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. There's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, if you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. Somebody testify.
You believe it tonight.
You believe it.
Have you received it?
You receive it.
Somebody testify.
You can feel it. Somebody testify. Testify. You believe it. You receive it. You can feel it. Somebody testify. You got pain. He's a pain taker. Lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Thank you.
Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. Oh, this man needs a basic kind of forgiveness at a price I can pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus on the mountains, in the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
There was Jesus
in the fire and the flood.
Jesus, we thank you for the truth in that. Somebody that's life parallels the rest of ours, if we'll look back, and if we look hard enough, or maybe if we just look subtle enough, there you are, right in the midst of, not waiting till we pull ourselves out. And so because of that, we know that you're here regardless of where life has us this evening in this room. You're there. And for those who can't see you, Lord, we're going to speak your name over this place and over them and over whatever it is that they struggle with this evening, the last song, before our next speaker, our first speaker comes. Do you trust him this evening? I hear those answers out there. Yes, Lord, we do. So we speak your name in great faith, singing.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom.
We speak your name.
I speak Jesus.
And this is why.
'Cause your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name
His presence to be here. Well, I'm excited about the events that are ahead of us this evening. This next man coming up, he needs no introduction. If I see him, there he comes right there. A night that is entitled Family, Football, and Faith. It embodies the Burlsworth family. It embodies the Burlsworth tradition. It involves their foundation. It just embodies everything about this man and his family and their legacy in our small town. So would you make him welcome to the stage, Marty Burlsworth.
Very good. Thank you for being here tonight. Thank you, everyone. We've got a great crowd. This is awesome. Thank you. Yeah, give yourself a round of applause there. Absolutely. Tell you, we've had some exciting times the last couple of days here. Vicki and I have spent two full days with ESPN here in our hometown. ESPN is doing a film on Brandon that will air next football season on SEC Storied, and we're excited about that. One thing, it's going to highlight Brandon, his career, but it's going to highlight Harrison, Arkansas, our hometown. Brandon was, it was faith, family, football. Faith, family, football. And he always kept his priorities right. I can remember years ago, not long after Brandon's accident, we were approached by a Hollywood producer about doing a movie. And I mean, this was out of Hollywood, out of LA area. And my question was, what input would the family have in the film, in the making of it? What goes into it? And their honest answer, they said, nothing. Once you sign off the rights, we've got to make what we feel comfortable with. What that didn't give us a real good feeling. So years later, we were approached by a local person out of Arkansas about doing the movie Greater. And he said, faith will not be taken out of this, because if the faith is taken away from Brandon, it's not Brandon, because that was first for him. Another little story. A few years ago, after we had a new athletic director at Arkansas, the first few days he was on the job, I went over to have a meeting. At that time, new construction was going on in the north end zone. That meant the old locker room was gone. And most of us in here know that for years, Brandon's locker was encased in glass in the locker room for the players to see. And so I went over and met with our new athletic director, and I'll tell you, what an impression right off the bat. He said he wanted us to be comfortable. He wanted my mother to be comfortable with where Brandon's locker eventually would be. It ended up in the Hall of Honor, which is perfect. But he said, if you want me to, I will drive to Harrison and go see your mother and make sure she's comfortable with that. That's the kind of person we have in charge of Arkansas athletics. And would you please make welcome Hunter Yurecek.
Thank you, Mark. Well, good evening. Good evening. All right, you guys give me a little bit of break tonight, because I get a lot of opportunities to talk about the Arkansas Razorbacks, but few and far between are the opportunities to talk about myself and my journey to where I am today, and why my priorities in life are my faith, my family, and college athletics. So I'm going to try to intertwine all that for you guys tonight, okay? Fair enough? So let's start first with how I got here. I was raised in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I was just a sports nut. Football, basketball, baseball, tennis, swimming, diving, golf, whatever it was, I wanted to do it. And God blessed me with just enough talent to have an opportunity to play basketball in college at Guilford College. Has anyone heard of Guilford College in here tonight? Okay, that will tell you how much ability God blessed me with. But I wouldn't trade that experience for anything in the world. My teammates in college are still my lifelong friends. So basketball was awesome when I was in college. But I couldn't find my passion professionally or what I wanted to pursue after college. I started out in college and I thought I wanted to be an orthopedic surgeon. Then I found out how many science classes you had to take, so I crossed that off my list. And then I thought I wanted to be a TV sportscaster, but then I was going to have to transfer from Guilford College because they didn't have that major at Guilford. Then my roommate was going to be a lawyer, and I said, well, if my roommate can be a lawyer, I can be a lawyer. Then he told me how much he was reading, and I decided I didn't want to be a lawyer either. So I graduated from Guilford College, and I was really searching. Here's how I was searching. The first 2 years out of Guilford College, I was a UPS truck driver's assistant. I was a lifeguard, a substitute teacher, an assistant high school basketball coach, and I worked in collections at a bank. I was searching. So I went back and I met with my athletic director at Guilford College and my basketball coach, who I thought were two of the people that really knew me well. And they said, Hunter, you love sports. You're organized. You have attention to detail. You've got a business major, and you love working with people. You can be an athletic director. I'd never thought about that, so I went back to graduate school at the University of Richmond and got my master's in sports administration there. From there, I got an unpaid internship at Wake Forest University. It was unpaid because I was so smart, I volunteered to work for free. But I did such a great job, after 6 months, they upped my salary for the next 2 years to $1,000 a month. And then the next 2 years after that, I was even so much better that they doubled it to $2,000 a month. So I was in athletic administration for 5 years and had made about $70,000. But you know what? I found my passion, and I wear this wristband every day. Do what you love and love what you do. And by working in college athletics, I had found what I loved, and I was doing what I loved. So that passion took me from Wake Forest to Vanderbilt, then Vanderbilt to Western Carolina University, from Western Carolina University to the University of Virginia, from the University of Virginia to the University of Akron, from the University of Akron to Coastal Carolina University for my first director of athletics job, then from Coastal Carolina to the University of Houston, and then almost 5 years ago to the University of Arkansas. Eight moves in 30 years, and you know what? I'm still married to an awesome wife, and we'll get to her in just a minute. But I truly believe God called me to the University of Arkansas, to the flagship university in this state, the only Power Five team in this state, no professional, major professional teams in this state, because he wanted me to have this platform that I have tonight to talk a little bit about how important faith is in my life. So about 25 years ago, as I was really busy, I sat down and I started to prioritize the things that were important to me in my life, my passions in life. And I can put them right now in three buckets, and they've been in three buckets for a long time. My faith, my family, and college athletics. And we'll start backwards in college athletics, okay? Some of you may say, what in the world, Hunter, does an athletic director do on a daily basis? Well, specifically at the University of Arkansas, my job is to create opportunities for our student athletes to have success. And I work with our head coaches and our assistant coaches and our support staff and our administrative team for our student athletes to have success academically, athletically, and in their personal development. That's my role as an athletic director. And I tell our student athletes each and every day, if you take and make the most of the opportunities that we're all working to create for you, that you'll leave the University of Arkansas with a degree, you'll leave there having competed for championships, and you'll leave there with the skill set to be a champion for life in whatever you decide to do. And our student athletes are taking that and making the most of those opportunities. In the past 2 years, they've had a cumulative grade point average of 3.27. We've had 98% of our student athletes who have exhausted their athletic eligibility have earned a degree, meaning they can no longer play their sport. They're leaving the University of Arkansas with a degree. We finished 7th and 8th in the Learfield Director's Cup, respectively, in the past 2 years. That's the first time we've ever been in the top 10. If you're not familiar with that, that takes the 352 Division I schools and ranks how their top 20 sports finish nationally. University of Arkansas has finished 7th and 8th out of 352 schools. And by the way, we only have 19 sports. We don't even have 20 sports that we can put into that metric. We've won 18 SEC championships. 18. The next two closest schools are Alabama and Florida. They've won 7 each during that same time period. We've had 9 teams ranked in the top 10, 14 in the top 25, and 18 of our 19 teams have gone to postseason. Our student athletes are having success. And so that's what an athletic director does. And that's one of those buckets that I have, my passion. I'm doing what I love, and I love what I do. That second bucket is my family. Jennifer, my wife of almost 29 years, has been with me every step of this journey. My passion for college athletics has become her passion for college athletics. My passion for faith has created her passion for faith. We've got 3 boys. Ryan is 26 years old. He played football at Marshall University. Then he had an opportunity to be on the practice squad with the Raiders and the Cowboys and is now an assistant tight ends coach at Austin Peay University. My passion became his passion. My middle son, Jake, started at the University of Colorado on their football team, saw the error of his ways and transferred to Arkansas, played on our football team, blocked a punt against Texas last year. Yep. And now he's a fundraiser for SMU in their Department of Athletics. My passion became his passion. And my youngest son, Brooks, is 18 years old. He's a senior at Fayetteville High School, plays football and basketball, and believes that he wants to be a college football coach as well. So my passion there became his passion. Okay, probably the most important passion, not probably, the most important passion I have, if I had my priorities in order, is my faith. Okay, so here's my faith journey. I grew up in a very strict Catholic home. My parents made us go to church every Sunday. I remember my grandfather vividly walking through several inches of snow when all the roads were closed to go to church. My dad would go to church every single day during Lent. I was led to believe that if I did anything wrong, I was going to hell. That was how I was brought up. That was the Catholic faith. That's how it was taught 54 plus years ago. Okay? And really, my faith never became an action in my life. And I remember a day, I had just moved to Akron, Ohio, and Jennifer and the boys had not come yet, and she'd asked me on a Sunday to go look at some houses in a community called Hudson, Ohio. And I was driving through that community, and as I was driving through that community, I came upon a church that had a marquee up front, and a church service was just getting ready to get started. I had not planned to go to church that Sunday, but for some reason, I pulled into that church parking lot, and I went to that service. The music was incredible. And the minister that day was a guy by the name of Joe Coffey. Joe Coffey played basketball at the University of South Florida. He was a sports nut. He gave an incredible, incredible message that day that resonated with me. I truly believe that God that day used Joe Coffey as a vehicle to talk to me and for my faith to finally become an action in my life, because when my family moved there, we joined the Hudson Community Chapel. I joined my first men's Bible study. I went on my first mission trip with Joe Coffey. And Joe Coffey taught me this practice 20-some years ago that I still use today, where he said at 5 o'clock in the morning, he would get up, get a cup of coffee, grab his Bible, sit in his favorite chair, and have his time in devotion and prayer before his family woke up. And then what that did was, his kids and his wife would come downstairs and see that light on and that cup of coffee sitting next to his Bible. And they knew that he had his time in devotion and prayer and set an example for them. And I wanted to set that same example for my wife and my kids. And you see, what happened when my faith as a leader of my household became an action in my life, it became an action in my wife's life, and it became an action in my kids' life. And so that was when my faith journey really took off. And then you fast forward to almost 18 months ago. I had taken a golf trip on a weekend out to California when we all thought COVID was over in May of 2021. I don't know if it's over yet, but I still hear reports of it. But, you know, we'd gotten used to watching church online. So I decided to tune into church online out in California in my hotel room. I attend Cross Church, really incredible minister and leader of that church there, Nick Floyd. And I love listening to Nick preach. He has some incredible message that seemed to touch my heart every time I hear him speak. Well, that Sunday, Nick gets up, and he starts to introduce a guest preacher. You know, I'm not really excited about a guest preacher. I wanted to hear Nick preach, okay? But I'm going to give this guy 5 minutes, okay? Guy's name is Robbie Gallaty. You may meet him in just a minute. I gave him 5 minutes. Then I gave him 10. Then I gave him 15. Then I gave him 20. I don't know how long he talked, but I listened the entire time. He talked about an incredible life story that maybe you'll hear a little bit about. But he also talked about growing up in a Catholic faith where his parents made a decision to have him baptized as an infant, just like my parents had. But he made a decision as an adult to wash away his past, wash away his sins, and be baptized as an adult. And it was his decision that time. Well, I thought Robbie was talking directly to me. But, you know, I'm out in California in a hotel room. He's not talking directly to me, right? He can't be. He can't know I'm watching. But you know who knew he was watching? God. And he was using Robbie as his vehicle to talk to me and about 200 people that got baptized that weekend at Cross Church. Well, the problem for me that day was I was out in California. I couldn't get baptized that day. But I tell you what, I went out and had one heck of a golf round that day because I was really excited about that. But the next day when I returned home to Northwest Arkansas, I called Nick and I said, Nick, I was watching church yesterday. I heard Robbie's message. He was talking to me. I want to get baptized. I want that to be my decision as a 52-year-old man that I get baptized in my life. So that following Sunday, we had an opportunity at the end of the service at Cross Church to get baptized, and I went forward to get baptized. And that was awesome. My wife was here. My three boys were there. My daughter-in-law was there. But here's what happened. The Fayetteville High School football coach, Casey Dick, was sitting behind me in church. He saw me get up. It moved him to get up. You know what happened after that? Five of his football players were at the same service. They saw their high school football coach get up. Five of them got baptized that day. So because I was obedient to God's call for me to get baptized, he used me that day, I believe, to be his vehicle and his messenger for Coach Dick, and then use Coach Dick to be the messenger to those five young men. So you never know. You never know. Like, I don't know what God's voice sounds like. Has anybody ever heard God? Can you tell me what his voice sounds like? I think it sounds like Robbie Gallaty. I think it sounds like Joe Coffey. And other people that God uses as vehicles to send a message to you. And he's going to use you. He's going to use each and every one of us if you listen to him. And you treat people the right way. Right? And you're kind to people. People will see that God is in you. And so that's my message today is you're going to hear God's call. It's not going to come from the heavens. It may be coming from the person directly across from you that's going to call you to him and be sending you a message that you need to listen to. And a lot of it has to do in how we treat each other. I'm done. That's all the minister I've got in me. Okay, so I asked permission if we could do this because we got a really big football game on Saturday down at Auburn. Okay, we haven't beat them in a long time. The last time we went down there, they cheated us out of a win, if you remember that. So I can think of no better prayer for God to know that we need a victory on Saturday than for all of us to stand up together and call the Hogs. Y'all ready? Woo! Pig suing. Woo! Pig suing. Woo! Pig suing. Razorbacks. Thank you.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Well, I already thought Hunter Yurecek was a good man. Now I know he's a great man. And how many people got led with a hog call by him this evening? What an honor, what a blessing. You bet. Well, the man that he spoke of is our keynote speaker for this evening. This evening is a culmination of that story times I don't know how many, but it was told to me in very similar fashion by someone else. And their life was moved and their life was changed. And that message was sent to me so that I could get caught up in it as well. And so tonight is a culmination of all that. And the message is here. So would you help me this evening make welcome to the Harrison, Arkansas stage, Pastor Robbie Gallaty.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. All right, yeah. No, you don't have to stand. Praise God. Was that not awesome? Hunter, let's give the Lord a hand one more time for Hunter. What a testimony, huh? Wow. What a testimony. You know, it just reminds me, you have no idea what one decision can do to start a revival in your life, your family's life, your community's life, your church's life, right? And it just shows you how God uses that. It's good to be in Arkansas. The last time I was in Arkansas, we saw an amazing move of the Lord at Cross Church. And as Hunter was saying, I love being in Arkansas. I'm from Louisiana, so I feel like I'm almost home. Amen. You know, like we're almost part of home. And my wife, Candy's here with me. She's from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Don't hold that against her. And our two boys, we have a great time traveling. We don't get to travel with our family. Our two boys are here. My executive pastor, Colin, his wife, Stephanie, and their son, Griffin, is here as well. And so it's good to be here with our family. And, you know, he didn't want me to say this, but I'm thankful for Clay and Heather Maxey. He actually had the vision for this. So, Clay, thank you, brother. Clay was the one who had the vision for this and got to become friends with him and Ben as well over the past just couple months. And so thank you, brother, for being obedient to the Lord. I want to tell you a story about a man in the Bible, and then I'm going to tell you my personal story about my own life. But I want to start by giving you a little context that in the first century, if a person was born blind, particularly a guy, they were actually born, guys were, for two reasons. A person blind had a problem, and you'll see. The first reason a parent had a child was because they wanted them to take on the family name. So if you were a boy, obviously you'd take on the family name. But the second reason was more important than the first, and that was you were supposed to work for the family. You're supposed to work and make the family money. But if you were born blind, you actually couldn't make the family money. You actually what? You actually cost them money. And so what a person blind would do is they would actually have to resort to begging. And so they would have two things that were really important. The first was a cup, and they would sit on a well-populated area, and they would hold this cup out, and they would beg for money. The thing that was the most prized possession was their cloak, though. And I want you to come in close and get this. The cloak served a dual purpose. What they actually found out historically was that the cloaks actually allowed them to have permits to beg. And so different cloaks were issued by different cities of different color. For example, like Jerusalem would have a gray cloak, or Jericho may have a black cloak, or Galilee may have a blue cloak. You get the picture. And so this man, Bartimaeus, is going to have this cloak. And not only could he beg with it, but he would use it on those hot Palestinian days to hold it over his head to shade himself from the sun. But then at night, what he would do is he would take that cup and he would pull it in to keep people from robbing him of his money. And he would wrap himself with that cloak because it would get really cool at night if you've ever been to Israel. And so this cloak, I want you to feel the weight of this. This was everything to him. This was his security. This was his comfort. This was his family. This was his 401k. This was his PS5. I mean, this was his cell phone. This was everything to him, right? And so if he loses this, I want you to see, he loses everything. File that away. If you have a Bible, turn with me to Mark chapter 10. And I want to teach you about this man named Bartimaeus, who was born blind. You can use your cell phone or iPad, or you just listen if you don't have a Bible. And I want to teach you the three steps that every person has to take in order to have a true born-again transformational experience with God. Because that's what I believe you're here for, right? I believe you're here because you realize there's more to life than what you can see. Amen? And that you really believe that in the deepest part of your heart that there has to be more to life than maybe what some of you are experiencing. And you'll see that from Bartimaeus. If you have a Bible, we like to say word when we get there at my church. So if you have a Bible or a cell phone and you're there, you can say, why? Because we know the word changes our life, right? Not cool stories, funny illustrations, although you may hear a few, but it's actually the word that changes our life. So at Long Hollow, the church I pastor, we say we want to get into the word until the word gets into us. Amen. So if you're there, you can say word. Say it like you mean it. Amen. Good group tonight, right? The word of the Lord. Then Jesus came to Jericho. And as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples, a large crowd was there. Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. Now the question is, what was he doing on the roadside? Audience participation part. He was begging, right? So he was begging. And then all of a sudden it says, when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." But many warned him to keep quiet. Another way to say that is they said, shut up. Don't you understand? We're on a mission here. Be quiet. But Bartimaeus began to cry out all the more, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." The first thing I want to teach you today, and I'm going to teach you three insights. The first insight I want to teach you is this. If you're taking notes, you can write some things down. If not, you can act like it. It makes you look holy. I'm playing. The first thing I want you to see is this. We need to take a stand for Jesus. right? Now, I don't know if it happened this way, but I want you to imagine Bartimaeus is going to go out with his cloak. And this is like any other day, right? I mean, he takes that tattered cloak around his waist and he's going to put it down on the ground. And he's going to start the day like he has every other day. For him, it's just mundane routine. And he sits down on his choice spot and he holds his cup out and he waits for the city. If you listen long enough, you can almost hear it come alive. He starts to hear the sounds of the women with jars and pitchers in their hands going to the well. You know, they say for people who lose their sight, they actually have an increase in their hearing, a more acute sense of hearing. He starts to hear the hooves of the donkeys coming with the vegetables and the fruit to the market. He starts to smell the smell of the fish that was caught in the Sea of Galilee up above. But he also hears in the distance someone running through town yelling the name of Jesus. Now, he'd never met Jesus before, we can assume, but he had heard about it. And Bartimaeus is going to yell out to Jesus something that is very significant here. And he doesn't hear the footsteps that day of two or three. I want you to listen. He hears the footsteps of thousands. Jesus starts walking by, and Bartimaeus yells these words out. He says, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Now, I want you to see here, just that line from this blind beggar is packed with theological meaning. In fact, I would submit to you that Bartimaeus teaches us more about Jesus than the Pharisees who were in the crowd, right? Now, what is he saying? I want you to take notes if you're writing things down, and write down two things. The first thing he does is this. He's going to tell Jesus that he knows who he is. Now, how do I get that? The phrase, Jesus, Son of David, if you know your Bible, is actually a code word for the Messiah. And the Messiah for the Jews was this long-awaited deliverer who would come and save them from this oppression of the Romans. And so he gets that from the book of Matthew. Now, if you have a Bible, turn with me to Matthew. And you'll notice that Matthew begins his Bible gospel with a genealogy, which is just a list of this guy begat this guy or this guy fathered this guy. If you're honest like me, sometimes you're tempted to read through that chapter. Anybody with me? You just kind of skip. Anybody want to admit that in church? Right? You skip over that. That's okay to admit. But in this lineage of Abraham to Jesus, you find this line. Look at it in verse 6. Jesse fathered David, King David. And then if you drop down to 15, you see Joseph fathered Jesus. Now, why is that important? Because Bartimaeus is saying, Jesus, I know who you are. But the second insight is as impactful as the first. He not only knows who Jesus is, you're going to love this, but he knows who he is. Well, how do I get that? He says, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on who? Me. Now, let me just explain what the word mercy means. Mercy is different than grace, right? So do we know each other? Have we ever met? Never, never met before. If I were to have $100 in my pocket right now, would you want that? Yes, okay, I don't have it, but if I did, you would be rich, right? It'd be a really good illustration. But since we've never met, if I say, come get the $100 bill and you take it, would there be anything in you that would say, I deserve this $100 bill? No. It's my stunning good looks that got me this $100, or my athletic ability, or how good I am as a... You wouldn't be able to say any of that because we don't know each other, right? You don't, quote, deserve it. That's grace. Grace, think of it this way. Is God giving you something you did nothing to earn or deserve? Mercy is different. Mercy is actually God holding back from you something you do deserve. Now, I have my two boys here, and my boys never get in trouble, but I've heard of boys who do. They may probably be talking now, for all I know, right? In fact, we went to the first service in Mountain Home, and we walked in, and they said, Dad, you're not preaching tonight, are you? We got to listen to you. Yeah, you got to listen to me all night tonight. And I was like, but if your child, you have rules and regulations in the home, and they actually disobey those rules, and you go to them and say, hey, listen, we said if you do this, this happens, but I'm not going to do to you what I said I would. I'm going to restrain and hold it back. That's mercy. Bartimaeus says, Jesus, I know who you are, but I also know who I am.
And all of a sudden, the crowd says, "Be quiet, man. Don't you understand? We're on a mission here." And what does he do? He yells out all the more, which is the point I want to make. You and I, number one, need to take a stand for Jesus. Friends, we live in a day and age today where the church doesn't need to shrink back, shut up, or push back our beliefs. We need to stand up straight and speak the truth and let the results rely with God. Amen. That's the world we live in today. People need to know not only what you believe, but why you believe what you believe. And I had someone say, "Well, I'm like St. Francis, go into the world and preach the gospel, and if necessary, use words." And I say, that's totally unbiblical. Paul says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We have to use words for people to be saved. And I tell people, some people may not know that the good you're doing and live by is because of Jesus unless you tell them. The reason I say this point from Bartimaeus is, think about how many times you've been in a service just like this, and you heard a preacher just like me. And when the time comes for the invitation, or for the response time, and you feel the calling of the Lord, you sense the presence of the Holy Spirit, how many times have you rejected the Lord, pushed back on God, because you were too ashamed to take a stand for Jesus? You were too worried about what someone may say about you, or what my kids may think something about me. I'm a deacon at the church, Robbie, or I teach a life group, or what would people think about me? Bartimaeus, coming close, was not about to let Jesus walk by his life without at least taking a stand and a chance on him. The second thing we see in the text is pretty fascinating, and that is after Jesus walks by, look at verse 49. The text says, Jesus stopped and said, "Call him to me." Isn't that amazing? That we serve a God, don't miss this, that is not too busy to stop and listen to us. Is that not amazing? Is this my water? No, this is the worship guy's water. That is somebody's water, but I don't think it's my water. Thank God I stopped when Jesus stopped. Amen. Jesus stopped, okay? So Jesus stopped. I love this. Why? Because it shows us that we serve a God that stops and listens. I don't know about you, but sometimes I think God would hurry up with things in my life, right? Someone told me a long time ago, God is always on time, he's just not on your time, right? Anybody with me? Like, God, I want you to just get on with the plan here. But one of the cool things about God, if you study the Bible, is there's only one place where God's in a hurry. He's never in a hurry. With the children of Israel, they wandered through the wilderness for how many years? Do you know this? 40 years. Supposed to be 6 months, right? A six-month journey. It's 40 years. But there's only one place where God is in the hurry. Do you know where it is in the Bible? It's in the story of the prodigal son. When the father, who's a picture of God, runs to a repentant sinner when he decides to return home. That's the only time God's in a rush. And so Jesus stops and he says, "Call him to me." And the text says, so they called the blind man and said to him, "Get up, have courage, he's calling you." Now don't miss this. Verse 50. Throwing off his coat, his cloak, he jumped up and he came to Jesus. Now, I don't know if it happened this way, but I imagine it could have. The text doesn't say that when Jesus calls him, Bartimaeus gets up. Remember, he's blind. He's surrounded by probably thousands of people. If he loses the cloak that I mentioned, this is everything. He loses it all. His livelihood, his comfort, his 401k, his retirement plan. The text doesn't say he folds the cloak up neatly and puts it in his choice spot to return to it. Doesn't say that. The text doesn't say that he takes the cloak and walks over to, sir, do you mind, hold this for me, I got to go meet with Jesus, I'll be back. Doesn't say that. The text doesn't even say he takes the cloak and tucks it in the back of his pants. It doesn't say that either. This is what the text says. I want you to feel the weight of this. The text says he gets to his feet, he throws the cloak aside, and he comes to Jesus. I want to ask you tonight, what's the cloak in your life that's holding you back from going all in for Jesus? Now, for some, it may be a consistent, persistent sin in your life, right? It could be pornography. Let me remind you, you cannot have one foot in the world and expect to have one foot in the kingdom and think you're following God. You can't. Maybe it's addiction. I'll talk about my own story in a moment. Maybe it's alcoholism. And some of you say, well, I'm not an alcoholic. I only drink Friday and Saturday night. Listen to me. If you drink every Friday and Saturday night, you have a problem with alcohol. I promise you. Because I did. Maybe it's an anger problem. Maybe it's a hypocritical attitude. You live one way at church and one way at home. And maybe it's something benign, right? Maybe it's something not even overtly sinful. It just is something that consumes your life. It's something that you need to throw away and come to Jesus. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do in just a moment. I'm going to ask you to name the cloak in your life, to grab a hold of it, and then present that and throw that before the Lord Jesus. After Bartimaeus throws the cloak aside, something else happens. So first of all, we need to, first of all, be honest with the Lord and take a stand for him. Number two, we need to throw the cloak away. Watch what happens finally. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" It's amazing because God is omniscient, obviously. Jesus already knows, don't you know that? Jesus knows what he's going to ask before he asks, but he still wants him to tell him. And that's how God works with us, right? Like, he knows what you need, but he still says, "What do you want me to do for you?" And he says, "Rabbi, I want to see." And Jesus says, "Go, your faith has saved you." And this is how it closes. Immediately he could see, got his sight, and began to follow Jesus on the road. Again, I don't know if it happened this way, but he throws the cloak aside. I want you to picture the scene. Bartimaeus has not showered probably in weeks or days, and he's unclean by the world's standards. Nobody wants to touch this man. And you have to realize why. The disciples are on the way to Passover at Jerusalem. I didn't mention this, but this is the last stop on the way to the cross. This is it. And Jesus is about to die on Passover. Now, Passover, one of the holiest cities or holiest festivals in the calendar, if they touch this blind man, they now have to be sequestered for 7 days in isolation in order to be cleansed. And so nobody wants to touch this man. He's unclean. He's been overlooked. He's looked over. And so he gets to his feet, and you have to imagine he's trying to stumble, and the crowd, picture it, parts like the Red Sea, right? And he makes his way over to Jesus, and he comes down, and Jesus is like, "Hey, what do you want me to do for you?" And all of a sudden, all eyes in that place are on these two men. If you're there, imagine the scene. All of a sudden, that eye socket that has never seen the light of day starts to well up with a tear, and through the dirt and the sand starts to trickle down his cheek. That other eye socket that hadn't seen the light of day all of a sudden starts to well up with another tear, and through the sand and debris and dirt starts to trickle down his cheek. And right before their eyes, with no sedation, no surgery, no doctor, no physician, watch this, miraculously, his eyes start to open, and standing before him is the light of the world. I don't think you heard what I just said. I think y'all missed that. Standing before him is God in the flesh. You got to realize this. The very first, I mean, think about this. The very first thing he sees, and for those who are believers in this room, isn't that what happened to us when we got born again, right? Like, we went from death to life. We went from darkness to light. We went from lost to saved. And the very first thing we see is Jesus Christ in our life. Now, the blind man doesn't do what I would probably do, full disclosure, because I would probably do one or two things before following Jesus, because the text says, Jesus says, hey, Bart, listen, go home, man. Like, you're healed. Just go back home. And the text says, no, he followed Jesus. But I probably would have said, boss, I'll be right back. Let me just make two stops. I would have gone to my parents' house and said, Mom and Dad, now that I can see, I don't need you guys anyway, and you kicked me out, so I'm done with you. I may have done that. I definitely would have found all the girls who turned me down for the prom. And I would have said, now that I could see, you're not that good looking anyway, actually, right? I mean, I don't know. Maybe, who knows? But that's not what he does, right? The text says that he followed Jesus on the way. And I want you to see this. Look at me. We all know people. Family members, friends, children, spouses, who at one time were passionate about the things of God. And somewhere along the way, the fire has fizzled out. And we think, what happened to them? You know, why did they leave? Why did they go back to the world? And we think, well, maybe they just relapsed, or maybe they just went back. And my response to you is, when you find out and meet the Jesus that I've met, why in the world would you ever want to go back to the world? Amen? Maybe the reason your faith is fizzled out is because it had a flaw from the first. Well, that happened to me, obviously, one time when I said a prayer and thought I was a Christian. I mentioned earlier, I wasn't always a believer. I wasn't always a pastor. I was raised like a hunter in South Louisiana. I was in a half Italian home. My dad was three quarters Italian and very Catholic, religious home, Roman Catholic home, which means we went to church every Sunday. If we missed church on Sunday, we went to confession on Saturday. We weren't Creaster Catholics, for those who know, like Christmas and Easter only, right, Catholics. But we went every Sunday, and I would go to church on Sunday, and I would live like I wanted during the week, and I would expect the peace of God to come over me so that I could go out on Monday and live like I wanted to Saturday and then come back and put on a mask and, you know, be with God again. And since then, I've realized that doesn't just happen in the Catholic Church, right? That happens in the Baptist Church or the Methodist Church, the Nazarene Church, the Presbyterian Church. And so I knew who the Lord was back then, but Jesus for me, and I don't know if you can resonate, but for me back then, he was like the tooth fairy. He was like Santa Claus. Like, he was like this special person, but not really real. And he was kind of out there. When I needed help, I could call him, obviously, but he really wasn't a person, and I couldn't have a relationship with him. But when I got older, God turned into this overbearing, domineering dictator that had a whip in his hand to crack every time I got out of line. Anybody resonate with that growing up? That's how I view God. And that was not the kind of God I wanted to serve. Now, just to share with you, that's not who God is, by the way. But that's who I thought he was. I played basketball for an all-boys Catholic school in New Orleans, and I got a scholarship to go to UNC Greensboro, which was a school in North Carolina. And the girl I was dating at the time was going to LSU. And she said, there's no way you're going to go that far away. You need to stay close to home. And so I literally, unbelievable as it is, I literally opened the phone book up, and I found William Carey College in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Has anybody ever heard of this school before? Neither had I. I mean, I didn't even know what it was. And so I called the coach up, and the coach said, school starts in 2 weeks. What are you talking about? I'm like, well, can I at least try out for the team? And he hesitantly let me try out. My mom rode with me to the tryout. And my mom said years later, she said, I have to be honest with you, son. I was there at that practice. And it was like everything aligned, right? You've been there, like everything worked out. I don't know if it was the stars that aligned or the planets. But I'm thinking something. I had Michael Jordan-like reflexes. I made every shot. And I look back and my mom said, I have to be honest with you. I rode with you that day. Son, you have never played basketball that good before that day. And frankly, you haven't played that good since that day. But on that day, right, it was like everything worked out. And little did I know, watch this. I didn't know this, but when I was down to nothing back then, God was up to something. He was working even when I couldn't see it. The coach gave me a full ride to the college. I went to play basketball at William Carey. The girl I'm dating at the time breaks up with me 2 weeks into the semester. She thinks I'm cheating on her, which I wasn't, but she thought I was. And now I'm stuck, unbeknownst to me before I got there, as a Roman Catholic on the campus of a Southern Baptist college. Okay? Yeah. Yeah. And if you don't know what that means, I was the target of every evangelism class on campus, right? Who's the project? It's Robbie Gallaty. There's the guy. Man, I didn't hide it. I cruised through the campus blaring the unedited version in the back of my Ford Mustang coming out of the 2 8-inch bazookas. I'm dating myself here for those who are with me. Blaring the unedited version of Tupac Shakur, right? I mean, I was lost and they tried to share the gospel. Well, the second year of my schooling there, a guy did something novel. This is going to blow you away. He did something radical. He befriended me. I wasn't a project to conquer. I wasn't a name on a sheet. I wasn't an assignment for a class. I was a friend. We shared the same likes and interests. His name's Jeremy Brown, and he basically earned the right to share the gospel with me. And he said to me in the room one night, he said, "Hey, you don't want to go to hell if you die, do you?" I said, "No." He said, "You know, if you died, you'd go to hell." I said, "No, I know that." He said, "You don't want to go there." I said, "No." And he said, "Well, repeat this prayer after me." And listen, I repeated that prayer verbatim as best as I could. And for about 2 weeks, I thought I was a Christian. And people have asked me since then, how do you know that wasn't the moment you got saved? How do you know you weren't born again at that moment? And here's how I know. Because for the next 2 weeks, my life somewhat changed, but after that, it looked no different than the life I had before. And one of the ways you can give a self-assessment, Jesus gives us this, a test to yourself, young people, listen, is you just ask yourself this question. Is the life I'm living matching the talk I'm giving? Another way to say it is Jesus said, the fruit of your life will prove the kind of life you have. He said, you could tell a tree by the fruit it bears. You remember this? And so what he says is, if you see a tree in the field and you don't see any fruit, just wait long enough and you'll say, that's an orange tree, or that's a pear tree, or that's an apple tree. But if the tree bears no fruit, you can say, that tree is not a fruit-bearing tree. Here's a line I came up with to really assess your heart. Write this down. The fruit of your life reveals the root of your heart. The fruit of your life, or the lack thereof, reveals the root of your heart. And so for me, there was no fruit. Before I got out of college, I got into a network marketing business. It was like Amway or Excel. It was very successful. I had tons of people in my downline. I got out of college. I thought I was going to be a millionaire by 22. And by the end of the year of 21 and into my 22nd birthday, the company went under. It was an illegal pyramid scam, and I lost everything. And I didn't want to do anything as far as business goes. I went through a season of depression unknowingly, and finally I decided, I know what I'll do. I have a college degree. I think I know what I want to do with my life. I want to be a professional MMA fighter. That's what I'll do, right? And so I decided to start training Brazilian jiu-jitsu and doing karate training and mixed martial arts training and doing tournaments. And I'm out at a club restaurant one night, and a guy named Gino comes up to me, and he's like, "Hey, listen, I need to ask you a question." I was 6'6", 290 back then, and he's like, "Hey, I got to ask you a question. Would you be interested in being the head bouncer of my club downtown New Orleans in the middle of Mardi Gras?" I'm like, let me get this straight. You're going to pay me to fight? I'm in, right? I mean, this is the job of a lifetime. So I take that job, and as you can imagine, it was the wildest 3 months of my life. I realized I needed a career change when I was escorting two guys to the parking lot, saying a bunch of things, obviously, I can't say now, and they pulled a gun out from under one of the guy's seats, and he pointed it at my head, and he said, "Now tell me what to do." And I thought, okay, I need a career change. I made a lateral move, which seemed right at the time, from bouncing to bartending, right? I mean, right now it makes no sense, but back then it made sense. And so I was a bartender for a while. I was coming home from work. Listen, this is when my entire life changed. My life changed on November 22nd, 1999. An 18-wheeler came across two lanes of traffic. I was going up the high rise of New Orleans, right by the city. He rear-ended me at 65 miles an hour, slammed my car into the guardrail. My seat actually broke off the hinges, and my seatbelt locked, torquing my back. I was 22. I went to the doctor. They sent me home with four things: Oxycontin, Valium, Soma, and Percocet. 60 of each. And you know people like this, right? We have family members and friends like this who are legitimately in pain. They go in for a knee surgery or a back surgery or a shoulder surgery or dental work or a car accident. And I was legitimately in pain. And so I'm taking the drugs every 4 to 6 hours. And you know the story. Within 3 months, I'm addicted to pharmaceutical drugs. And I have to find a way to fulfill this insatiable desire to get high. I can't work. I can't train. I can't make a living. I just want to get high. And so I take the business knowledge from the network marketing world and I bring it into the drug world, and I start for 3 years an illegal import business where I start trafficking drugs from Mexico to Miami. In the beginning, we had tons of money. I was trafficking hundreds and thousands of ecstasy pills a week, GHB, Special K, which is not a cereal, marijuana, cocaine, heroin. And I'm not telling you any of this, don't miss this, to impress any of you. But I want to impress upon you just how far the Lord has brought me from. Times were really good in the beginning. I had a ton of money. I mean, if you would have looked at me by the world standards in 2002 that year, I had a brand new Cadillac CTS, just had come out, black on black, 20-inch chrome Katana rims, $9,000 stereo system in the trunk. And I tell you that to say, if you would have seen me on the street, you would have said, Robbie, you have everything the world has to offer. And for a season, I thought I did. But even back then, when I was an unbeliever, I would put my head on the pillow at night, and there was this still small voice, now I know it's the Holy Spirit, that would whisper in my ear the same thing he whispers to some of you, and he would say, there has to be more to life than this. You had to be put here for something greater than this. Times were good until I ran out of money. I didn't know what to do, and so I decided to take the credit card number from my father when he wasn't looking, and my family, close Italian family, very close with my family, but I was desperate. And so I went to my dad's wallet, took his credit card out, memorized the number. My dad had a small business, almost bankrupted the family as I charged $15,000 23 years ago on the family bank account. When my mom and dad found out about it, my mom called me the week before Mardi Gras that year, and she said, Robbie, your dad is disappointed, and I'm furious with you. Don't ever come to this house again. You're not welcome here. And in pride and arrogance, I said, you know what, Mom? I don't need you guys. I never did. I don't need you now. I hung the phone up. I took the little bit of money I had and blew it on drugs and alcohol. And for the next 3 months of my life, I lived hell on earth. We rather get high than pay the bills. And so they started slowly turning off the gas first, then the electricity, and then the water. And we lived without those three utilities for about 3 months. We mastered the art of the cold shower in winter, no hot water, no hot air. We'd get into freezing cold water, we'd get out, we'd lather up, we'd get back into the water because we wanted to get high. We weren't worried about paying the bills. The bill collectors called till they turned the phone off, and eventually they kicked us out the apartment. And I went back to my parents, who were unbelievers at the time, and I basically asked them to take me back in. Now, here's just a sidebar for those who are struggling with addiction, or you have a family member or a friend. I'm going to give you the greatest insight that I learned through that process. Since that time of being sober, if you can imagine, over 20 years, I've counseled probably hundreds, maybe thousands of people. And every time I see, listen to this, every time I see a perpetual drug addiction that continues on, you can always trace it back to an enabler. It's a family member, normally a mom, sometimes a dad, who wants the best for their child, wants the best for their husband, wants the best for their family member, and out of love, they continue to perpetuate the addiction by paying for that. It wasn't my mom in my case, it was my dad. And for me, the rent was always due twice a month. The cell phone bill was always due three times a month. And I could manipulate my father enough to pay for it. And my dad, out of love, thought he was helping me. He was actually killing me. You got to remember, there's only three avenues for an addiction of any kind: jail, institutions, or death. See, this is how sin works. You may say, well, I don't have an addiction. If you have an addiction to drugs, if you have an addiction of any kind, here's how addiction works. It's always the same narrative. An addiction of sin, of any kind, sin will always take you further than you want to go. It will always cost you more than you want to pay, and it will keep you there longer than you ever want to stay. And so my parents took me back in, and by the grace of God, they brought me back in, and they took me to my first rehab treatment of all places, Tijuana, Mexico, right? I mean, it's another story for another day, but I went to Tijuana, I came back, and was clean for about 9 months. I relapsed back on drugs again, and people ask me, why did you go back the second time? Because I did it without Christ. See, the reason you need Jesus to set you free from a sin or addiction is because you need someone outside of yourself, namely the one who created you, to set you free from the shackles that enslave you. Listen to me. You cannot fix yourself. I don't care how smart you are, how intellectual, how educated you are. You cannot fix yourself. The one who created you can set you free from the problem that has enslaved you. And so I was desperate after my second rehab treatment. And literally, I would love to say I was a spiritual man who knew the gospel well and really thought this through, but I was desperate. And I basically, in my room, I wasn't in a church service, not in a revival service, nothing like this. I was in my room alone. And I thought, you know what? I tried everything else. I may as well try Jesus. And I didn't know the gospel completely, but here's what I did. I took the little bit of faith I had, and I put it in as much of Jesus as I knew. And in my room that night, I had this 24-hour radical Paul-like conversion that the day God saved me, it doesn't always happen, but for me, the day God saved me, he called me into ministry. I knew I was going to be a preacher. I didn't know what that meant. And so you can imagine my dad the next morning when I said, "Dad, you're never going to believe this. I'm saved, and God's called me to preach." And he said, "Son, what are you smoking?" You know what I mean? Like, what are you saying? I mean, he didn't know. But here's what people ask me. What did it for you that night? I want to share with you four things. As the worship team comes, they're going to play softly. I want to share with you four things that changed my life. I understood this. Number one, I understood for the first time who God was. See, I had known who God was, but the weight of it in that room, I realized that God was the one who created everything. Like, God created the stars in the sky and the planets in the atmosphere and the land we walk on and the trees we see and the food we eat, but he also created us. And the Bible says he created us in his own image after his own likeness. And because of that, I felt the enormity of the weight that one day I was going to give an account to that God. Do you realize this? Like, one day you and I are going to stand before God and give an account for everything we have done. Number two, I knew I had a problem, and the problem was I knew I was a sinner. And I'd known enough from catechism and college Bible classes that Adam and Eve in the garden rebelled against God by eating the fruit that was forbidden. And because of that, sin entered the world and affected everyone who's ever been born. Now, you got to understand, sin is way worse than a mental illness or a physical disease or a terminal sickness. Why? Because those things end with this life. Sin has repercussions and ramifications for eternity. Now, I know what you're thinking. Well, Pastor Robbie, I'm not a sinner like you. I don't have a sin problem like you have. I'm not a drug addict or an alcoholic. Well, the Bible says if you've sinned one time, you've broken the whole law. One sin. And so I'll give you a quick test. Have you ever stolen anything before? Full honesty here. Change off a dresser, answers off a test. Some of you students, you ever done that before? The Bible says, this is a hand, by the way. Raise your hand if you've done, yeah. I mean, we all have, right? I mean, have you ever told a lie before? A big lie or a little lie? Anybody ever done that? If you don't raise your hand, you're lying, right? I mean, so that's a lie right there, right? I don't know you, but maybe, right? Have you ever, here's the one that gets you. Have you ever, it got me, have you ever looked at a person with lust in your heart before? If you admitted to any of those things by Jesus' own words in the Sermon on the Mount, you're a lying, thieving adulterer. And so, like you, I knew I had a sin problem, but the good news was, for the first time, I saw who Jesus was and I knew who I was, and I realized that Jesus lived a life that I couldn't live, right? Like, he lived a perfect life, came to a group of people that didn't want him, died a death that I should have died. And that by dying death, he conquered death and offered me an opportunity to live, not just in the moment, but for eternity if I accepted him. Now, the fourth thing I realized in the moment of that room I was in was that when I understood that, I had a choice to make. Listen to me. See, whenever someone shares the good news of the gospel, you cannot remain indifferent to the gospel message. In fact, you have to either accept it or reject it, but you can't be indifferent. And so you're hearing what I just said, and some of you are going to reject that. You're going to say, "Hey, listen, I'm not here to accept that message in my life. In fact, I just came to hear a story about a guy who was a former drug addict and now he's not. I mean, I'm not here to accept the gospel, and so I'm going to reject that." You have a right to do that tonight. But you need to understand what you're rejecting. The Bible says if you reject the gospel, and you go out of this place the same way you came in, if you keep living the way where you're the captain of your own ship, the leader of your own life, the driver of your own car, that's okay, but you're going to experiences, the Bible says, judgment and condemnation, not only today, but for eternity. And you're going to spend eternity in a Christless place called hell. But here's the good news. See, this is what I knew that night, November 12, 2002. I knew that if I accepted the message of Jesus, not only did I have a place in eternity waiting for me, more importantly, I had victory today over sin and sobriety over issues in my life. But more importantly, I was filled with the Holy Spirit to live this abundant life Christ promised. And I wouldn't be under judgment. I wouldn't be under condemnation. I wouldn't have the guilt and shame that I had lived with for so long. Now, at this moment, you're saying, well, that's great, but I'm not ready. I'm not ready to make a decision, Robbie. I don't want to make a decision tonight. That's okay. But you need to understand this. This is the weight of it. To not make a decision is to make a decision, and that is to reject the gospel. Friends, I've come here tonight to offer you the same transformation that Jesus offered me 20 years ago. And I'm here to tell you, listen to me. God can do more in a moment than any man or woman can manufacture in a lifetime. Do you believe that? God can do more in a moment if you get serious with Him. And so I want to pray over us right now. And I'm just going to ask the Lord's blessing on your life. And I really believe there are some in here today who would, if you're honest, put your stuff aside and just get alone with the Lord, kind of a posture of prayer. And I want you to close your eyes. And I'm going to ask you a question. Do you know that you know that you know that you know Jesus Christ? And the question is not just, do you know Jesus? The question is, does Jesus know you personally? If you're unsure of that, or maybe something I said tonight resonated with you, or maybe you've been bound up with consistent, persistent sin in your life, and you want freedom and victory and abundance and satisfaction and joy that comes only from Christ. You're saying, I want Jesus tonight. I'm going to ask you right now, just no one looking around but me, and obviously we can't see anybody anyway in here, but I'm going to ask you just to do something out of your comfort zone. I know this is bold, but I'm going to ask you to do it. And I'm not asking you to do anything differently than I did when I was sitting in your seat not long ago. If you're ready to surrender your life once and for all, completely to Christ, and to go all in for Jesus, to throw the cloak away and say, I'm all in, would you just boldly right now slip your hand up right where you are, and just and you're not saying anything, you're just saying, Pastor Robbie, pray for me. Would you pray for me? Thank you, brother. Thank you, sister. Anyone else? Hands all over the place. Anyone else? Pastor Robbie, would you pray for me? Thank you, sister. Anyone else? Just slip it up right where you are. Thank you. Hands all over. Young person, if you're here tonight, if you're a single mom or dad, Pastor Robbie, pray for me. I'm unsure, but I want to know that I know tonight. Would you just slip your hand up, brother? Pastor Robbie, pray for me. Thank you, sister. Anyone else? I see your hand. Amen. Anyone else? Thank you, brother. Anyone in the back? Maybe you're saying, man, I hope this pastor's done so that he can move on, and I'm not ready. Listen, I'm talking to you. Jesus never allowed people to come to him secretly. Even Nicodemus at night, he called him to come publicly, and at the end of his life, he came publicly. Every person that saw Jesus do the miraculous came out publicly. You talk about Bartimaeus, Jesus, son of David. Be quiet. No, Jesus, son of David, have mercy. There was a woman who was bleeding for 12 years. She was on her hands and feet and knees, crawling to Jesus, risking persecution and imprisonment because she wanted to be healed. If you're desperate enough for change, you'll be bold enough to stand for Christ. I'm going to ask you one more time. Anyone else? Pastor Robbie, that's me. You struck a chord with me. Thank you, brother. Is there another? If you raise your hand, I want you to raise it one more time. No one else looking but those who raised it. Just raise your hand, extend it at the elbow so I can see over you right now. Just raise it high if you did that. And if your hand is raised, I want you just to look at me right now. No one but those with hands raised. You can put your hands down. If you raise your hand, just look at me for a moment. No one else. Praise God. Just look at me for a moment. I want you to know how big of a deal this is. It's a big deal. And I know how God works because I know how he's worked in my own life. God can do more in this moment than anything anyone can do in your life, past or future. And so here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to stand right now. I want to pray a blessing over your life. So if you're looking at me, just stand right where you are. Praise God. Just stand right where you are, and I'm going to pray specifically so that I can see you. Praise God. Don't you dare be ashamed of this moment. Amen. If you need to grab the hand of your wife or your parents or the person you came with, just stand right where you are. Thank God. Praise God. You just stand right where you are. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Thank you, brother. Just stand right where you are. Praise God. I'm going to pray over you. So come over here, and I'm going to pray over you specifically. So just come here in the front. Brother, would you come? And I'm just going to ask you to pray right here. If you just in the stands, I promise you come back. Your stuff will be there. Just going to pray for a moment, and then we're going to go back. But would you just come down? I know this is a big ask for you, but I promise you, when you take a step of faith for God, God meets you right there where you are. And so I'm going to ask you to come. Praise God. You guys come. Amen. Amen. If you wanted to come and you're saying, hey, I needed to come. If you're going to go home and regret that you should have come but didn't, then you need to come. Praise God. You guys come. Anyone else need to come? Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hey, God is going to honor, listen to me, God is going to honor your step of faith tonight. I promise you. And I'm going to pray in just a moment, the guilt and the shame and the pain and whatever sin of the past or the present that you're dealing with will be taken off of you like a weight off your back, and we're going to ask the Lord to work. Amen. Praise God. Others have come. Listen to me. You come. The Bible says, when you hear the voice of God, do not harden your heart. That's what the Bible says. I read it in Hebrews yesterday. And so what that means is this. Listen to me. You either come, listen to me, you come when the Lord calls, or you may not come at all. And here's what I mean. When was the last time your heart was strangely warmed or you felt the tugging of the Holy Spirit like this? And so I'm going to ask you, if you need to come, I'm going to pray for these. These have already come, praise God. But if you need to come, even as I'm praying, if you need to come, you come. If you're a believer here, would you extend a hand out? And would you join me? We're just going to pray right now. We're going to thank the Lord for what he's doing. Father, I thank you so much for the boldness of these men and women who have stood up, God, and said, I want more of you. I pray right now, God, that they would cry out to you in the quietness of their own heart, and they would say, Jesus, I know I've done some things against you. Would you say that to the Lord? I know I haven't lived in a way pleasing to you, but I know Jesus did. And I'm asking him to come into my life. Would you say that, God? Would you fill me with your Holy Spirit? God, I'm praying right now that the power of your Spirit rest heavy upon these men and women, God, as they commit their lives to you. And that the pain of sin and the guilt and the shame of their past, God, would you set them free? God, we come together as a church tonight believing that you're going to set them free from addiction. You're going to set them free from sin. You're going to set them free, God, from any persistent sin in their life that has been shackling them, that they're going to walk differently. There'll be a lightness in their step tonight. And they're going to leave this place, God, experiencing victory and sobriety. Not because of anything they can do, but because of everything you have done. And so I'm praying right now, God, that you save them and change them. And when they go home, their family and friends say, what happened to you? You don't even look the same. They would say, it's Jesus. And so we say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We ask it in the only name we know how. And that's the strong and powerful name of Jesus Christ. Everyone said, amen. Look at me for just a moment. Let's give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Hey, I want you to look at me for just a moment. One of the things that changed my life, look at me for a moment, was not the mountaintop experience. I heard a pastor say to me one time, everybody jumps high when they get saved. The question is, how straight do you walk when you come down? Everybody hits a mountaintop. What changed my life was people investing in me. A guy named David Platt invested in me. I was an 8-month-old Christian. And because of that, my life was forever changed. Here's what I want to do. We're going to help you in this thing called the Christian life. And so we want to walk with you. There's some pastors
In the back, where are they at? Where are the pastors at? Okay, over here. Yep. I'm going to ask you to follow this pastor right here. Just make your way. We're just going to get some information. You're going to come right back. We're going to sing a bunch of songs. I promise you, you'll be back in time. We're just going to get some information so we can follow up with you and help you walk this Christian life. Amen. So, brother, would you just make your way over here? There's just some pastors and volunteers here. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a hand for them. Amen. And just make your way for just a moment, and then we're going to come back. Amen. Let's stand tonight and praise the Lord for what he's... Yeah, let's give the Lord a hand. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. What a decision. Amen. Hey, never let us get over being saved. Amen. Never let us get over being saved. We're going to continue to worship through song. If you want to make this area an altar before the Lord and do business with God, you're welcome to do that.
Celebrate this truth as God is moving. Here, sing it.
I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child. Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song, a deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone.
I'm no longer a slave.
I'm no longer a slave.
Yeah. two, three, go.
Like I've never known. I keep my eyes on the sky, 'cause my soul wants to fly. Lord, my heart is ready to go.
I wanna know how it feels to make my way down the streets of gold. I wanna know how it feels to have a talk with the saints of old. To rest my feet by the river of life. I've heard of heaven and I know that it's real. I want to know how it feels.
Sometimes I get weary from this life that I live. It seems that peace is something I'll never find. I try to hide my load and all that I've got to show.
The look of love on my Savior's
face. I wanna know how it feels to make my way down the streets of gold. I wanna know how it feels to have a talk with the saints of old. I wanna know what it's like to rest my feet by the river.
Turn the house lights up a little bit. We're going to play some music as they continue to. We just want you to fellowship. The evening is beginning to come to a close. What a great night it has been. Thank you so much for being here. Harrison and churches, thank you so much for being here, Holy Spirit. What a wonderful night. God bless you all. As your family comes back out, you are dismissed. God bless you.